Hi everyone and welcome to the Captain's Video Blog. We are Tuesday, January 24th, 2017. So, in yesterday's video blog I talked about, you know, the interest of the Marseille execs for Patrice Evra. And, you know, I was like, well, but he's only gonna come for 6 months on loan and all that. Turns out that I was wrong, because if the rumors are to be believed, the offer that Marseille wants to do to Juventus and to Evra himself is apparently, I would guess, a full-fledged transfer and a contract for Evra to stay 18 months. So yeah, that's a year and a half until the end of the 2017-2018 season. So yeah, the World Cup in Russia. That would be the end of Evra's spell at Marseille. Though, you know, there's been also talks of a 1 year extension being added, you know, depending on the results, I guess. Yeah, I gotta say, you know, it's not long term, 1 year and a half, you know, or 2 years and a half, but it's already not short term anymore. You know, you gotta think about the involvement of the player when he arrives in January. Some players, they are trying to make a name for themselves, or, you know, try to just get their value up, and some players, they are just trying to get some play time, and I would guess that Evra falls into the latter category, so I wouldn't doubt his involvement, but still, you know, a year and a half is already better than half a year. You know, when you think about long term, you would probably rather think about, you know, players like Yuto Nagatomo, despite the fact that he's already 30 and might as well have signed an extension with Inter. So yeah, it's probably impossible. And Ricardo Rodriguez would be actually a nice addition to the roster. You know, young player turning 25 this year, I think. But the problem, because there's always going to be a problem, is that he's also a target for Paris. Yeah. And you know, when you're a French club, when you're a French club with some money, snagging a player from Lyon is already pretty difficult. But from Paris, it might as well be, you know, mission impossible, because Paris, they are backed by a state, the state of Qatar. Yeah, lots of money. Marseille are backed by a man, an entrepreneur, Frank McCourt. Sure, he has created an investment fund, I think, with the guy who bought the Dodgers from him. Yeah. And there's a capital already of $2 billion, and McCourt wants to create a legacy in Marseille and all that. But, you know, he's not just gonna sink $2 billion in the club from the get-go. I guess that Evra might be as best, you know, the best that we might get this winter. I don't know, I'm just talking out of my ass right now. I guess that it's all that I had to talk about before moving on to Raw, Monday Night Raw. They were in Cleveland, Ohio, pretty far from Texas, if my U.S. geography is right. Yeah, and, well, once again, it didn't feel like a go-home show, at least for most of the show. You know, the most important part was the end, the very last segment. Definitely, you know, just, they were, the stakes were at an all-time high, and yeah, just, whoa, boy. But we'll talk about that later. To be fair, when the show started, it had Roman Reigns, number one contender for the Universal Championship, former US champion, and the shark cage, you know, inside of which Chris Jericho will be locked and he will be hanging 20 feet above the ring in the match between Roman Reigns and Kevin Owens. Yeah. Roman Reigns cracking jokes, ha ha ha. Chris Jericho in the air, I'm taking the championship, baby. Well, he doesn't say baby, but because he's not the New Day, so yeah, that's basically that. It didn't seem to amuse one Chris Jericho and one Kevin Owens a lot, though. Yeah, because, I'm gonna be honest here, Chris Jericho was pretty funny in his anger at Roman Reigns mocking his acrophobia, you know. Was talking about, here's Chris Salamico and all that. Oh boy. And he was so angry that, yeah, Jericho pretty much talked himself into giving Roman Reigns a rematch for the US title. Wait a second, I'm gonna turn on the light, maybe it will look better. Not much better, but still. Roman Reigns was like, what? Okay, sure, I'm taking that. And you know what, at the end of the Royal Rumble, I will be both the US and the Universal Champion, because I'm the guy, and that's something that you're never gonna be, Kevin Owens. And just, okay, sure. Now, you know, if, you know, just after that segment, they hadn't said that Goldberg was going to be on Raw, I would have probably thought that, yeah, once again, Raw has booked the main event during the show. Like, if Goldberg hadn't been here, who would have been in the main event without that match? The Cruiserweights. And I'm not knocking on the Cruiserweights. It's just, they are treated as filler. First match of the night. And that one was planned before. Sheamus faced Luke Gallows with a nice little announcement that at the Royal Rumble pay-per-view, Sheamus and Cesaro would be defending their tag team titles against, well, the Good Brothers, Luke Gallows and Karl Anderson. And to avoid, you know, some shenanigans, there would be two refs. I would have liked the two refs, because holy shit, the shenanigans are how Luke Gallows won. Yeah, it was an okay match. You know, with Sheamus getting assaulted ringside by Karl Anderson, because yeah, I guess that you know, you just gotta prepare the battlefield. And yeah, he also distracted the referee while Luke Gallows was tapping out to the sharpshooter, opening the way, you know, for Gallows to put his finisher on Cesaro. So Luke Gallows won, and therefore Gallows and Anderson come, you know, to the Royal Rumble, or coming to the Royal Rumble with kind of an advantage, if, you know, just only mentally. Yeah, maybe a bit physically too, because I mean, they took a beating, to be quite honest, the champs. I've learned later in the evening that this match would be on the kickoff. It makes sense, you know, I'm not a fan of championship matches on the kickoff, but you gotta realize that Sheamus and Cesaro are supposed to be in the Royal Rumble match, and you know, as much as it is at the end of the pay-per-view, and the pay-per-view is going to last 4 fucking hours, yeah, it's still, you know, you gotta have some rest after a match with such physical personalities. So yeah. Still a little bit backstage, a little thing backstage with Sami Zayn, who wanted to enter the Royal Rumble. Yeah, he was like, how do I do that? Do I fill out a form or something like that? And Stephanie was on the phone, and she said, no, you're gonna have a match with Seth Rollins. Yeah, so much like Titus O'Neil, except that Titus O'Neil is pretty much a thing from real life, but Sami Zayn, it's in kayfabe. Sami Zayn will have to face Seth fucking Rollins to be in the Royal Rumble. And not only that, but Seth, you know, at first, you know, might, when he was informed of this match, he might as well have thought, yeah, I guess I can let Sami Zayn win, you know, and get a spot in the Royal Rumble. No, he was informed that actually there's this little tagline that I've heard literally for the first time while watching Raw. You know, friends versus friends, foe versus foe, everyone for themselves, something like that. For me, the tagline of the Royal Rumble was "Remember the Rumble," which was, yeah, it's haha, you know, we're in San Antonio, the Alamo, ha ha ha, remember the Alamo, ooh boy. So yeah, if Seth Rollins loses, he loses his spot in the Royal Rumble. Ha! So this match took place pretty much immediately. It was a technical masterclass. Yeah, it was fucking amazing, and it was stiff. Yeah, that kick in the face of Sami Zayn, Jesus. Sunset flip power bombs and all that. You know, the pedigree on the ring apron. And all of that just for Seth Rollins to job to Triple H's theme. Yeah. Triple H's theme just started, you know, it hit. And yeah, it played for probably a full minute before Seth Rollins just got himself into a schoolboy pin. So Sami Zayn is going to the Royal Rumble, and Seth Rollins will certainly be an annoyance during the Universal Championship match. Yeah, just to get to Triple H. Then, what else? The Cruiserweights! So, yeah, talking about filler, Tony Nese and Drew Gulak and Arya Daivari faced Jack Gallagher, Mustafa Ali and TJ Perkins. It was the match, you know, to make Mustafa Ali truly cement his face turn. You know, they aired a little vignette when they were like, yeah, so, you know, when you hear Mustafa Ali, you just suddenly get the idea, and I want to break the stereotypes. And the first way in which they broke the stereotypes was when they announced him as coming from Chicago, Illinois, instead of coming from Karachi, Pakistan. Yeah, that's a step in the good direction. And, you know, he was the one to win with his reverse 450 splash. And, you know, a move like that, it couldn't be a move for a heel. You know, the dude could be called, I don't know, Hillson, my Hillinson, and would still probably get cheers because of just how cool this move looks. So yeah, good victory by the three faces. I don't like that gentleman Jack Gallagher is a thing. Yeah, gentleman. Why do you feel the need of adding gentleman to a dude who, you know, already is introduced as the extraordinary gentleman? It's redundant. Oh, God. Anyway, the New Day in the ring, they talked about, you know, being in the Royal Rumble, and they talked about, you know, being cut, interrupted 3 weeks in a row by Titus O'Neil. And just as they were starting to get, you know, to get serious about the Rumble, they were interrupted by Enzo and Cass. And, you know, in turn, they got interrupted by Rusev and Jinder Mahal and and Lana. And, you know, Rusev was like, yeah, so why Big E and Big Cass do you need to state the obvious? It's like as if I was called Handsome Rusev. And I would call him Handsome Rusev. You know, Rusev. That's a great name. amazing. Just great, great stuff. I love Rusev. He's great. So yeah, Titus only arrived. He was like, yeah, so we're gonna have a 8-man match. And we're like, but we're 5 and you're 3. But yeah, who's your 4th man? It's fucking Braun Strowman. Holy shit. So yeah, I thought that it was going to be a 5-on-3. But no, it was a 4-on-4 with Braun Strowman getting the pin on Enzo Amore. Like, it was a fairly forgettable match. That's, you know, that's one of the things where you're like, how the fuck is that the go-home show? You know, you would, I don't know, but it just doesn't make sense. So yeah, but after the match, probably a thing that will be replicated during the Rumble, you know, while Braun Strowman was towering over all of his fallen, you know, opponents of the evening, and maybe even some of the guys he was teaming up with. Big Show arrived and they had a stare down. Oh boy, two big men looking at each other. That's great. Yeah. Up next is the US title match between Chris Jericho and Roman Reigns. So yeah, nothing too important about that match. To be fair, you know, it was a pretty good match, I gotta say. There was some, you know, some good violence, but the most of the violence that I, you know, that I can really talk of is, holy shit, Kevin Owens laid the smack down on Byron Saxton on commentary. Like, how the fuck is he going to recover from that? Well, apparently it seems that he can recover from that when Kevin Owens isn't there, because Kevin Owens cost Jericho the match by attacking Roman Reigns. So yeah, basically Jericho retained the title. They tried to put Roman Reigns in the cage and have it being lifted up. Didn't work out that well because Owens was the one in the cage. Yeah, Chris Jericho tried to hang from the cage, ate a Superman punch and then a spear. Yeah, and you know, just to add to you know the good stuff, it was announced that the match between Kevin Owens and Roman Reigns would be no disqualification. So yeah, even more reasons for Seth Rollins to fuck with the match. Yeah, that's going to be great. I don't know, just. I just don't like it that much when you suddenly add some, you know, some stipulations. Like, it would have made sense to make that a no disqualification match from the get-go, because that's how Kevin Owens retained the title at Roadblock End of the Line. But you make it a no disqualification match literally the week before the Royal Rumble, and suddenly you're like, well, I mean, you're not trying to prevent the events of the last pay-per-view. You're trying, you know, to make it so that really one guy has really some sort of an advantage over the other one. So yeah, it's it was a fucking disgrace. Yes. Anyway, Nia Jax faced a woman called Ray Lynn. Yeah, it was in two, as Corey Graves pointed out. And I mean it was short match, because you know, just by the way I'm talking about Nia Jax's opponent, well, she was a jobber. So yeah, quick match. Nia Jax cutting a promo that didn't help her. Yeah, she talked too fast, probably influenced by the what of the crowd. Like, I don't agree with the what, but yeah, just the promo wasn't good. Might be a bit too condescending, I don't know. Yeah, you know, as condescending as Charlotte, who was in actually sitting. You know, she had a little you know, face-to-face interview with Corey Graves. Like Bayley, actually Bayley might be part of the Ascension. Like, she has the Eye of Horus tattooed on the back of her neck. Yeah, that's strange. Illuminati and all that. Oh boy. I mean, it would be a cool storyline to have, you know, Bayley just going, you know, at one point she snaps and she decides to be the face, the female face of the Ascension. That would be great. The only problem that I have with Bayley currently is that she reverted back to her character of NXT before she was a serious contender for the title. Yeah, I mean, she's been a serious contender for a title with her fangirl, nervous fangirl persona, but well, I mean, when she got more serious about it just kind of disappeared. She was still happy-go-lucky and, you know, really, you know, charming and all that. It just was, she was, the nervousness just disappeared. Yeah, something that's in my brain. Anyway, Nia Jax started bad-mouthing the career, Sasha Banks actually, and Sasha Banks just went to the ring. Just she snapped, basically. That's what she did, and she went with a crutch at Nia Jax. Didn't have a, you know, wasn't very effective, gotta say. Yeah. After that, the Cruiserweights. Yeah, more Cruiserweights with Rich Swann versus Noam Dar. Fairly short match, fairly fun match, with Rich Swann winning with the Swan Song, you know, big kick in the face. Yeah. Cedric Alexander was backstage because on 205 Live he faces Neville, and you know, he felt like he had put Alicia Fox and Noam Dar behind him, and guess, you know, where they came from? From behind him! Yeah. God, Alicia Fox, she's so overdramatic. Yeah, that's something. You nearly made him cry. Okay, sure, yeah. Anyway, Sasha Banks versus Nia Jax is also going to be on the kickoff. Ah, that's great. Anyway, Goldberg apparently hit his head on the door. It's something that he does to hype himself up, but he made him bleed from the forehead. He fucked up his promo like several times. Paul Heyman came to the rescue, talked about the luck of the draw. Yeah, you could see Goldberg versus The Undertaker, Goldberg versus whoever you want, Goldberg versus Brock Lesnar. And speaking of the devil, Brock Lesnar was here. Are you gonna come to like a man, or are you going to be a dumbass? Apparently, Brock Lesnar doesn't like being called a dumbass because he rushed to the ring, you know, like nice little face-off, and suddenly, The Undertaker. Oh, what a way to end the show. Like, that's where the stakes are high. Like, you feel like it's going to be a huge match. Right? Still wanted a brawl. Maybe we'll get that on SmackDown. Probably going to get that on SmackDown because I've heard of a Lumberjack match. Yeah, that's fun. So, yeah, anyway. Thanks for watching. See you tomorrow. Bye.